Real quick survey first. How many of you have actually purchased from Zappos before? Oh, wow, thank you. Very cool. So for those of you who may not know anything about Zappos, we've been around for almost 15 years and grew from no sales in 1999 to 2008 was the first year we hit $1 billion in gross merchandise sales. We're actually now doing about triple that. And internally, we have a saying that we're a service company that just happens to sell shoes. And so our whole philosophy is, rather than spend a lot of money on paid advertising or paid marketing, instead invest that into customer service and the customer experience, and then have our customers do the marketing for us through word of mouth. And really long term, it's just about building the Zappos brand to be about the very best customer service and customer experience. For all that focus on customer service, and we're thinking, you know, maybe 10 years from now, there could be a Zappos Airlines or Zappos Hotel that's just about customer service. The number one priority of the company is actually not customer service. Our number one priority is company culture, and our whole belief is that if we get the culture right, then most of the other stuff like delivering great customer service or building a long-term enduring brand or business will just be a natural byproduct. And so this is actually an internal chart that we use in terms of how we think of the Zappos brand. It's something we refer to as the three C's. And it's about initially customers know that we have a great selection of clothing and footwear, and then they learn about our customer service, and then they learn about our company culture. So we've actually had customers tell us that when they get that perfect outfit or perfect pair of shoes, that Zappos is happiness in a box. So whether it's the happiness that customers feel from getting that perfect outfit or perfect pair of shoes, or the happiness that customers feel from experiencing great customer service, or the happiness that employees feel from being part of a company where the personal values actually match the corporate values, the things that we realize ties all of these three C's together, is that Zappos is really just about delivering happiness, whether it's to customers or even to our vendors and to our employees as well. And hence the name of the book that came out in 2010 that I wrote. So I remember when the book came out, it's been almost 4 years now, we were talking about delivering happiness and people said, okay, I get it, happiness through clothing and footwear, customer service, company culture, what's next? And for the longest time, actually, we didn't have a great answer to that for that. And one of my favorite quotes, I think it was from an executive from one of the major ad agencies, is that a great brand is a story that never stops unfolding. And we were trying to think of, okay, how does the story of Zappos unfold next? This is actually our previous headquarters in Henderson, which is a suburb of Las Vegas. And we actually offer tours of our offices, so would encourage next time any of you are in Vegas to come for a tour. We'll pick you up from the airport in a Zappos shuttle, give you a tour, and then drop you off at your hotel afterwards. And just a few months ago, we actually moved from Henderson to the former City Hall in downtown Las Vegas. The city actually just moved into a new City Hall, and it was pretty fun. We actually had a ribbon cutting. We set a new record. We had a ribbon that was a mile long, and then we had over 1,500 employees and friends simultaneously cut the ribbon. So it was a world record for the most number of people simultaneously cutting a ribbon. And then somehow we decided it was a good idea to have a happy hour afterwards with 1,500 pairs of scissors running around. And so we've actually been looking for a long time to build our own permanent campus, at least 6 or 7 years, maybe even longer. And it was surprisingly hard to find anything available in the Vegas area. And then we found out the former City Hall was going to become available. And so we're super excited to finally have a place where we could call home and have everyone under one roof. Because in Henderson, we had actually grown and expanded to 3 different buildings. And that actually had a negative impact on our culture. The employees at the top of the hill never saw the employees that were in the other 2 buildings. And so super excited that we were able to build this campus. And I myself toured campuses like Apple and Nike and Google and amazing, beautiful campuses. I remember when I was at the Nike campus, there was one building that had a running track around it. And then there was another building that had an on-site pub, and we thought to ourselves, we need one of those as well. And then, so I emailed our employees and asked them, you know, what should we build in our dream campus? And got lots of suggestions, including an on-site gym, an on-site pub, and a library, hundreds and hundreds of different requests. But the number one request we got back from employees was actually doggy daycare. More than human daycare, but. And so we realized a couple things, actually, as we started getting all these requests. We realized that, one, we just couldn't possibly physically fit all these ideas into just our campus. But the other thing we realized was that all those other campuses, Apple, Nike, Google, were great for our employees, but were actually really kind of insular and didn't really integrate or contribute to the community around them. So we thought to ourselves, what if we decided to actually turn the entire idea inside out? What if instead of focusing on just ourselves, we really thought about the ecosystem and took an approach that was more analogous to NYU, where the campus kind of blends in with the city, and you don't really know where one begins and the other ends, where employees are actually encouraged to go out into the community and the neighborhood, and we also encourage people that are out in the community to come into our campus and really have that intermingling between community and company. Right around the same time, this was a few years ago, a bunch of Zappos employees, including myself, actually discovered this area of downtown Vegas that most tourists don't know about. Most tourists, when they think Vegas, think all the big casinos on the Strip, which, as it turns out, technically isn't even in the city of Las Vegas. Or if they know anything about downtown, it's the overhead light show, the old casinos, and so on. But if you go to this area called Fremont East, it's almost the complete opposite of the Vegas that most people typically know. There's no gaming, and if you go into any of the bars or coffee shops, you would have no idea you're in Vegas. And it's actually the most community-focused place I've ever lived. And I actually grew up in the Bay Area, but I've never lived in a place where the bar owners hang out in each other's bars just to support each other. And so, by magical coincidence, this area called Fremont East was just a few blocks away from the former City Hall that was going to become our future headquarters. And so we suddenly had our answer in terms of what's next for Zappos, in terms of how do we keep growing our brand and how do we expand beyond just clothing, customer service, and company culture. We decided to add a fourth C into everything that we do, and that fourth C being community. And so we've done things like held a skating event downtown and have build a skate ramp and have professional skateboarders, invite the community in, and then also have employees go and bond, and that helps build company culture. And then we'll live stream that. That goes to our customers that are interested in skate shoes, but at the same time, it integrates the story of our company culture and community in for all our customers. So that's really how we're thinking of moving the Zappos brand forward over the next several years. So that's Zappos. I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk about Downtown Project, which is actually a separate company that's funded by myself, Fred, who joined Zappos about the same time I did, and a couple other friends. And it has a $350 million budget, and you can see roughly how the budget is being allocated. And there's a few different goals. One is to help create a place where you have everything you need to live, work, play within walking distance. Another is to help make Downtown Vegas the most community-focused large city in the world, and probably the place most people would least expect it. And third is to make it the co-learning and co-working capital of the world. And co-working started, I think, in the Bay Area maybe 8 or 9 years ago, where there were different tech startup companies working in the same physical space. And what they found through that was that there'd be these unexpected, serendipitous collaborations where people would overhear each other's conversations and then start working on projects together. And ultimately, that drove a lot of innovation and productivity. And since then, this concept of co-working has turned out to work so well that there are literally thousands and thousands of co-working spaces all around the world, and not just in tech, but also in fashion and culinary. And you can really imagine building co-working space around anything that you can build community around. And you know, community is a word that I think gets overused sometimes. And so we wanted to come up with a very specific and maybe more measurable definition of community. And so for Downtown Project, we have our own three C's, collisions, co-learning, and connectedness. And by collisions, it's really talking about when people are out and about in the neighborhood in a semi-public setting. So it could be walking down the sidewalk or in a restaurant or a bar or a coffee shop where there's an opportunity for them to collide with someone serendipitously. Co-learning refers to having the people in the community help educate each other. And because for different businesses that are involved, one may be great at marketing and another one may be good at accounting and really have the community help itself. And by connectedness, we refer to the number and depth of relationships in the community. And the other principle that we're really focused on for Downtown Project is really about combining density with diversity. So the big bet is by focusing on these three C's, collisions, co-learning, and connectedness, not only will that lead to a happier and luckier community and neighborhood, but actually innovation and productivity increases. And unlike a lot of real estate developers, you know, that have short-term or medium-term cash flow or ROI goals, instead of us focusing on the short-term ROI, we're really focused on maximizing the long-term ROC, return on collisions, return on community in terms of the way that it was just defined. And this other acronym that I stole from Jim Collins' latest book, Great by Choice, ROL, return on luck, which sounds like a really weird thing to try to manage, but we actually have metrics, very real metrics that we're measuring in terms of how do we actually make the community luckier? How do we accelerate serendipity in the community? And I'll share some of those with you later on in the presentation. So here's a quick breakdown. We have $50 million set aside for small businesses to help build a sense of neighborhood and community. And this is actually my apartment wall. We actually have tours that go through my apartment for Downtown Project. And we're very anti-top-down master planning and master programming. Instead, when people come in on the tours, we just ask them, what do you want in your dream neighborhood? And if it's not already on the wall, we encourage them to write it down on a post-it and put it there. But the other cool thing is every once in a while, we get someone whose lifelong dream is to, say, retire 10 years from now and start a cupcake bakery. And we say, well, rather than wait 10 years, why don't we invest in you now, and you can start living your dream now, and it'll help build community and help shape out the neighborhood. And we have a few different criteria. We want them to be owner-operated. Unique, first, or best is really important to us. It needs to be self-sustainable in the long term and story-worthy, and it helps promote collisions. So this is Natalie, and I serendipitously met Natalie about a year and a half, 2 years ago, at the local coffee shop. We had a collision. And it turns out she had worked for 10 years as a chef at one of the casino properties and had just quit her job and was packing up her bags to head back to Santa Fe. And as we started talking more, realized and learned that her lifelong dream was to open up her own breakfast and lunch place. And so this actually ended up being one of the first small businesses that we funded and showed it under construction. And, oh, I'm not really a PowerPoint person, but I'm very proud of this transition, so we're going to look at it one more time. Thank you. So you can see her under construction, and this is, and she actually opened up 1 year and 3 months ago, and is doing about triple her initial projections, and it's become this new daytime community hub where if you're in the community and you go eat there for an hour, you'll run into 5 or 10 people that you know during the course of your meal. And the reason why I know it's 1 day and 3 months ago when she opened was because last night we just had a party for Natalie, where she paid back the original investment, the final, in 1 year and 3 months. So, and now Natalie's learned a lot of lessons over the past year or so and is ready to help mentor the next generation of entrepreneurs that want to open up their own restaurant. This used to be a check cashing place a couple years ago, and Sarah decided her lifelong dream is to open up her own boutique clothing store. And she describes it as a hangout place that just happens to sell clothes. So people in the community actually stop by several times a day. They'll co-work out of there or just hang out. We actually opened up a few months ago. It might be the world's largest shipping container park, made out of shipping containers and also these modular cube structures. This is actually a guy named Ernie who used to work at Zappos several years ago. He found his passion was barbecue sauce and barbecue meat, and we actually decided to fund him for his own restaurant. And I happened to be walking by, and that's literally his restaurant being lowered down behind him. And so the idea behind the container park is actually make it such a fun place for kids that they're begging their parents to go back every weekend, but there's also live music and the adults can hang out with each other, and really it's brought a lot of families and kids and diversity to what was actually 2 years ago an area where I myself would have felt unsafe being there at night. And then inside these containers, we've got about 40 different spots where aspiring entrepreneurs can actually try out new business ideas. So this is one of the other small businesses that is getting their start in the container park. Think of it as almost like a small business incubator. We opened up a health clinic that's almost more like a membership model, not an insurance based. So think of it like a gym membership where they're actually incented to keep you healthy and have check in on you, have the health coaches check in on you several times a day. In the past year, we've relocated about 60 tech startups from other states or even countries, actually, to downtown Vegas. And when we ask them why they're moving to downtown Vegas as opposed to anywhere else, we get two reasons. One is really the sense of community. And the other reason is really this whole idea of thinking of the city as a startup. And how many opportunities in a lifetime do you have to help shape the future of a major city? I'm going to fast forward through some other slides. We actually converted a former casino into a co-working space and lounge. These are the before pictures, and then this is the after picture. And again, it's all about daytime and nighttime, bringing people in the community together to connect with each other. And also partnering with Venture for America, Teach for America, and all of this is about bringing additional energy and creativity and this entrepreneurial energy to downtown Vegas. We opened up an early childhood center that's teaching kids entrepreneurship and creativity using the latest neuroscience research, and partnered with the founders of Burning Man to actually do the first urban burn in downtown Vegas. And we're also bringing large-scale art to downtown Vegas, and this is actually 45 feet tall, and I found out you can crawl up in there and put a DJ on top. But the idea is, because Vegas is really no more as a driving town, and the idea is every block or so have some sort of fire element, some sort of large-scale art to kind of trick people to walk one more block or just one more block. And there's the praying mantis from Burning Man. And then Life is Beautiful, actually. We launched this festival last October and actually fenced off 15 city blocks, which has never been done before in any city. So it was almost like Coachella meets South By. And it was its own music festival, 65 bands, its own culinary festival, 50 celebrity chefs, its own art festival. We had muralists come and paint 16 different walls. And the cool thing was after the festival, most of those pieces of art stayed up. And its own learning and speaking festival. So I actually have a video to show you that was actually put together by one of our other small business investments, Downtown Films. And like a lot of videos I've seen, sometimes make the event seem much better than it actually was. I really like this video because I feel really perfectly captured the whole vibe of the Life is Beautiful Festival. So let's play that video.
We are the music makers. And we are the dreamers of dreams. We'll be right back.
We had 60,000 people come over 2 days, and actually it's going to be last weekend of October this year, and hopefully we'll at least double that number. But the cool thing is, for most of those 60,000 people that came, it was their first exposure to downtown, and then we heard afterwards from the small businesses that in the weeks afterwards that their business was up because a lot of people wanted to come back in normal life and really try out those restaurants and so on. This is a great book that I would recommend, Triumph of the City. It's super interesting. It's written by a Harvard economics professor that studied cities from all different time periods, like Rome, Detroit, New York, and looked at why some thrived and some didn't. And a lot of the findings are actually really counterintuitive, but it's actually guiding a lot of our thinking for a downtown project. One of the most interesting findings is that every time the size of a city doubles, innovation or productivity per resident increases by 15%. But you find the opposite happening at companies. As companies get bigger, innovation per employee generally goes down. And the ingredients for that to happen are you need a residential density of 100 residents per acre, combined with street level activity, so all those post-it notes you saw for those residents to collide with each other, and this culture of openness, collaboration, and sharing, where I viewed this as a multiplier. If people are twice as likely to share and collaborate, then maybe you only need half the residential density. And we do a lot of thinking about how do we actually get more collisions. And at Zappos, we think about how do we get employees to collide in the office environment. And now with Downtown Project, we're thinking about how do we get people in the community to collide with each other as often as possible. And so the big bet is, and this is just a partial list now, put all these creative entrepreneurial groups together in a relatively small space that have a bias to collaborate and share and be helpful to each other. And statistically, the magic will just kind of happen on its own. This is actually the building that I live in, and we have about 100 furnished apartments here that we've set up as essentially free hotel rooms. So anytime myself or other people meet someone interesting, then we just say, hey, next time you come to Vegas, stay with us, and then it basically tricks them into going to the local coffee shop and the local bars and so on. They discover a whole new area of Vegas that they never even knew existed. And so one way we've talked about what we're trying to do in downtown Vegas with Downtown Project is it's almost like the TED conference meets South By, meets Wisdom 2.0, meets Burning Man, but as a lifestyle instead of as annual events. And so when people come and stay with us, we actually just ask them, hey, as long as you're in town, do you want to give a talk to the community about whatever you're passionate about? And 95% of them say yes. And so it becomes this ongoing free content for the community. To the point where we actually bought this building at Fremont and Las Vegas Boulevard, it's probably the most prominent intersection of all of Las Vegas. And rather than turn it into an easy moneymaker like a bar or a restaurant or something else, we actually just built the Inspire Theater. And you can see it under construction. And the idea is, imagine if Wednesday afternoon through Sunday afternoon, anyone in the community or any visitor can just walk in and there's someone giving an inspirational talk about something. And there's also co-working spaces, with the West Coast's largest magazine selection, an automatic book printing machine, and other things that are in that space. And so we've actually started theming each of the different weeks, and I don't have time to go through all of these because of time, but I'll make this presentation available for anyone interested. This is a fashion incubator that we've opened for the fashion week. But what I wanted to actually really quickly touch on is the math that we're doing to increase the luckiness of the community. And started thinking about, okay, what is the value of a resident like me and when I'm out and about in the neighborhood? And I started doing the math. Well, I'm out and about when I'm there 3 or 4 hours a day, 7 days a week. I travel a lot, so 40 weeks a year. It actually works to about 1,000 collegial hours a year for a resident like me. And then we have this guy named Jake who had the most successful fashion-related Kickstarter campaign, raised over $1 million on Kickstarter, and we were trying to convince him to move. For various reasons, he couldn't move from New York to downtown Vegas, but we said, well, what if, Jake, you actually come on a regular basis once a month for a week and do talks like how to have a successful Kickstarter campaign and mentor other entrepreneurs, which he's been doing for actually quite a while now. And when he's out and about 12 hours a day, 7 days a week, 12 times a year. It actually works out to about 1,000 collegial hours a year. So now we have this, in addition to people moving to downtown Vegas, we have this other way to accelerate the innovation and collaboration, and we've been calling this subscribing to downtown Vegas. And so we basically took the 100 residents per acre formula and changed it to 100,000 collegial community hours per acre per year, which works out to 2.3 collegial hours per square foot per year, which just gives a whole new way of looking at real estate and the types of investments that we make. So if we're going to invest in a 3,000 square foot restaurant, we can see whether our estimates will yield at least that much in terms of getting people in the neighborhood to collide with each other. And so the big bet is by focusing on these three C's, collisions, co-learning, and connectedness, what we want people to say about downtown, whether they're just visiting for the first time or subscribing or living there, is that downtown Vegas will make you smarter, which, you know, it's probably the last thing a lot of people would normally associate with downtown or Vegas. So there's three different companies I'm involved with. Zappos, Delivering Happiness, which actually has a booth in the Inspiration Village here that focuses on helping companies develop their own strong cultures, and Downtown Project. And we try to have this theme of inspiration go through all three companies. And we just passed a threshold in human history where for the first time ever, this is just in the past few years, first time ever, 50% of humans now live in cities. And within our lifetime, that's actually gonna jump up to 75%. So we view what we're doing at Downtown Project as much more than just about downtown Vegas or the Vegas area. And a lot of city revitalization projects depend on having an expensive sports team or stadium or a Harvard or Stanford, and not every community can have those things. We specifically chose the three C's of collisions, co-learning, and connectedness because we wanted something that could be replicated to other communities and other cities. And so for us, it's a lot like the story of the 4-minute mile, where for those of you who may not know the story, for the longest time, people thought it was impossible to run a mile in 4 minutes. Or they thought, oh, if you could, as soon as you cross the finish line, you'd probably collapse and die, and that would be bad. And so people thought it was impossible. But then, in 1954, this guy named Roger Bannister broke the 4-minute mile. But what I found really interesting is that in less than a year, other people broke the 4-minute mile as well. And it wasn't that nutrition was better on Earth that year. It was just people believed it was possible. And so if we can make downtown Vegas, a place voted probably by many as least likely to succeed, if we can make downtown Vegas a place of inspiration, entrepreneurial energy, creativity, innovation, upward mobility, and discovery, and all that good stuff, if we can make that happen in downtown Vegas, then hopefully that'll help inspire other communities and cities to reinvent themselves, and we can be the 4-minute mile for the world. Feel free to email me for a copy of this presentation, tony@zappos.com. And I just want to end on the quote that I really like. A great brand is a story that never stops unfolding. I think the same is true for a company. So for those of you that have your own company, I would encourage you to think about how does your brand continue to unfold. I think the same is true for a city. And I think the same is true for a community. And that's why I am so excited to be a resident of downtown Las Vegas, because I can't wait to see what unfolds next. Thank you very much. Thank you.